And the analysis of Shields and Brooks, that is Syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Welcome, gentlemen. So we just heard Gwen's discussion. It is 60 years after the Brown versus Board of Education ruling. And we know, Mark, that yes, there have been dramatic changes in the aftermath of that. But we also know, and we've got a graphic to show this, that much of some of the country, maybe even much of the country, is still segregated. Here you see, this is a chart showing the difference between 1968, 2011, big drop in the percentage of African American students attending majority black Latino schools in the South, where segregation was most prevalent. You know, here it's a drop from 78% to 34%, but we see drops in the Midwest and the West. But Mark, is it surprising that in the Northeast the percentage of African American students has risen?
I don't know if it's surprising, Judy. I think that Cheryl Cash and I, first of all, remember this on that decision. It was 9-0. If you want to see a great politician at work, that was Earl Warren. Thank God you had a governor, somebody who had actually been through the process. He assembled that 9-0 coalition, which gave it its moral and political momentum behind that decision. But Judy, I think Cheryl Cashin put it very well in her discussion with Gwen and the other panelists, and that is it's a question of place, not race. I mean, we're talking about income inequality, we're talking about property inequality, and that's essentially what leads to school patterns in school populations.
Yeah, I suspect they would have been surprised if we'd gone back and asked them, what do you expect over the next 50 years? I suspect they would have thought there'd be a little more progress than we've experienced. And I think that's because there was a supposition from my reading of the history books is that once you took away some of the legal barriers, that some of the social barriers would fall more quickly than they have. And this is measurable not only in the school segregation, but even in social interaction. When you measure how many people are having real interactions with people of different races, it's surprisingly, we've made surprisingly little progress, especially maybe in the first few years after Brown or Civil Rights Act, but in the last couple decades, it's been surprisingly slow. And that's in part because birds of a feather do flock together. People do tend to residentially segregate, in part because some of the discrimination, but in part, I think, because of a loss of emphasis on integration. That there was, especially in the 70s and 80s, a little less emphasis on integration, a little more on multiculturalism and things like that. And you just kind of keep pushing and pushing and pushing. Maybe among people under 20, we're beginning to see a shift in that, but progress has been surprisingly slow on that.
Pushing how? What kind of pushing?
Well, you know, we're in a new regime, a non-affirmative action regime based on race. I think we're entering that regime, but you still have to push based on other things, based on, you know, companies, universities, schools. I do think have to pay attention to this, and not only getting people in, but once in, ensuring those social interactions are there, and there's not segregation in the cafeterias and things like
that. Yeah, no, but segregation is encouraged by colleges. I mean, that barely is. I mean, not simply by race.
Student housing.
By student housing, right. and the cultural housing and all the rest of it. I do want to point out, Judy, that of all the gender, racial subgroups in the country, the highest per capita, those enrolled in college is black women. There are black women enrolled in college and university at a higher level than white women or Asian men, Asian women, white men. Black men are enrolled at a higher level than per capita than white men. We've quadrupled the number of black college graduates in just less than a generation. So, I mean, there is good news. I just think occasionally we have to pause and reflect on the good news.
On the gender aspect.
And on the racial aspect as well.
Right. Well, complete change of subject, and that is presidential politics 2016, David. We saw both former President Clinton, former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, come out swinging this week after Karl Rove, who, of course, was former President George W. Bush's top political strategist, suggested that Secretary Clinton might have had brain damage from a fall she took.
Yeah.
While she was still in government.
He didn't use that phrase, but he said that she was in the hospital and we should get to the bottom of all this.
But, I mean, is this the kind of exchange we're gonna see? In fact, President Clinton said to Gwen in an interview, he said, we can just expect this from Republicans.
Yeah, well, a couple things going on. First, I hope Rove was just speaking off the cuff because it was pretty stupid what he said and inaccurate, and it was stupid. The response was interesting. Because there has been, among the professional people who, like us, who watch this thing for a living, there has been some whispers from people who pretend to know what they're talking about that maybe she won't run. And I guess that's still kind of true. But the way the Clintons came out swinging makes it look like they're going to run. And so that was interesting. And then if you're going to have a race in a Democratic primary, picking a fight with Karl Rove is a pretty good thing to do. And the Koch brothers, you know, that all works pretty well. So I think we learned they're maybe a little more forward-leaning about this whole deal than anybody who thought they weren't. And I do think, I still think that I'm less bullish on her chances to get the nomination. I think it's likely she'll get the nomination if she runs. Hmm. But I'm a little less bullish than a lot of other people around here, because I do think the party has moved to the left. The de Blasio mayor's race in New York, even the Baraka race in Newark, where the more leftward candidate probably won, I do think the party has shifted a little away from her. And so I think there's some shot that it's not going to be a cakewalk for her.
30 days in the hospital, wrong. 3 days in the hospital, and that she was wearing glasses that were only given to people who had traumatic brain injury. That was Karl Rove. Now, you may not have seen the stethoscope, and you hadn't may not seen his bedside manner before, Dr. Rove making house calls like this. It's a little bit called putting heroin in the bloodstream. I mean, you let out a libel or a rumor, and you just kind of let it go. Oh, where did it come from? And then somebody hears it it's a couple of months later, something of the sort. It's symptomatic of the Texas candidate. There was a congressman in Texas. He may very well have been a Karl Rove client, who had a very difficult opponent. He said, I'm going to accuse my opponent of being romantically and sexually involved with a barnyard animal. And his campaign manager said, you can't do that, Congressman. We have no evidence, no proof. No, I know we don't have any evidence or proof. I just want to see him deny it. And that's what this is. This is that kind of a charge. It was stupid, and I think it did help the Clintons. But it does tell you something about the high level we can expect in 2016 in the campaign. Yes.
The one thing, though, it will not be an issue if she runs. Running is arduous.
Yes.
And if you can run, your health is fine. And so if she's running and she can do it the way every candidate has to do it, her health will not be an issue.
Mark, what about David's other point that maybe Hillary Clinton, assuming she does decide to run, may not have that easy path to the nomination?
I don't think inevitability is a winning campaign strategy, and that's basically right now what the strategy is. Everybody's for Hillary. Why? Because everybody's for Hillary, and because she's leading in all the polls. I mean, I think there is a restlessness and a restiveness in the Democratic Party against the Obama administration, although unspoken in large part, about the fact that all of the people who brought this country to its knees in the Wall Street crisis continue to go to dinner parties and fly off in private jets and get welcomed at the White House, and they pay fines. I mean, we've basically is monetized financial crime. You just pay a check. Nobody goes to jail. And I think there's an anger. And Elizabeth Warren is probably the catalyst for that, the most logical point for it. Somebody will pick that up. Mrs. Clinton may very well try to move in that direction, although coming as a senator from New York, it would be a departure.
And we have an interview with Senator Warren on the NewsHour Monday night.
I wanted to promote that.
You were putting in a plug. So just in a few minutes left, the Tea Party, David, they want us one of these Senate primaries in this midterm election season, but they don't seem to be as strong as in the past. The whatever you want to call it, the mainstream, the establishment of the Republican Party seems to be doing better. What's going on?
Yeah, I think, and somewhat, especially in this case in Nebraska this week, the lines were very muddy between who was establishment, who was Tea Party. The Tea Party candidate who won says he's a Yale PhD. and the other, Tom Cotton, is a Harvard law degree.
Yeah.
Mike Needham, who runs the Heritage Fund, Heritage Action, he's from Manhattan. So these are not classic outsiders, I would say. But I do think the party has become more nervous of losing seats. The voters. It's less over ideology and more over approach. It's, can you come into Washington and do politics, do governance, as opposed to being sort of a Fox News commentator when you get here? And so I do think the side of the party that says, you know, let's pass legislation, they're plenty conservative, but they tend to have the momentum right now. And I think the government shutdown that Ted Cruz led was a major turning point, which is not to say that his campaign won't be formidable when he runs for president.
Ted Cruz and Mike Lee were staunch supporters of Ben Sasse out in Nebraska, the winner. And their message was, we need reinforcements to fight the entrenched leadership here in Washington. Sasse, to his credit, kind of had a foot in each camp.
This is the Nebraska
In Nebraska,
winner.
And did it quite adroitly. I think the Tea Party had its most important victory. And we can see it every day, and that was in Kentucky. Mitch McConnell went hat in hand and asked Rand Paul for his endorsement, to avoid any trouble. And Rand Paul, who's now a national figure and a major leader of his party, endorsed Mitch McConnell and probably thereby secured the fact that McConnell would be renominated. But that's how important the Tea Party is, that Mitch McConnell, who opposed him in 2010 when he ran, is now his supplicant and in his debt.
Neither one of you two is a supplicant. We're going to have lots more occasion to talk about the Tea Party and the establishment. We thank you both.